I know you're gonna dig this.
This is Rhine McLin, host of the Funk Music Hall of Fame and Exhibition Center's award-winning show, Funk Chronicles, recorded live here at DATV Studios in Dayton, Ohio, zooming all the way from Plainfield, New Jersey. Kevin Goins, leader, founder, guitarist, and lead vocalist for the funk group Quazar. Also, Kevin is a former member of the group Space Cadets. Welcome, and thank you for agreeing to come on our show. Hello, Kevin.
Hello, how you doing?
I'm doing good. I'm so excited about talking to you. I can't wait to get through this interview so I can talk about the Space Cadets, because I just like that name. But I want to start, how did you get started in music?
Well, before we get started with that, I'd like to just say thank God for being here. And, we basically got started in church. You know, my mother and father, my father played, my grandmama played.
Well, what instrument did your father play?
Father played guitar. My grandmother played guitar.
Your grandmother played guitar?
Yeah, I still got her guitar to this day, yeah.
Oh, yeah. My goodness. I would really like to have seen your grandmother play the guitar.
I wish I could have seen it a little while longer myself.
So tell me, you started in the church. What denomination? Was it Kojic? Was it Baptist? Was it Methodist?
Kojic, Church of God of Christ. Yep. Church of God of Christ, yeah. And one of our churches that we went to was in Trenton.
New Jersey.
Yeah. Yeah.
So how old were you when you started playing?
When I first started playing drums in church, I was about 5. And then my brother Glenn, he was playing, him and my father was playing, and guitar just seemed like they were just having a ball over there in that corner in church. So, and I wanted to do that too. So grandmama showed me a few chords, and it just blossomed from then on, you know? Between that, because we just sit around the house half the time. All you did was either just play or be in church. If you familiar with church, you know we went to church like Monday, Tuesday, Wednesday, Thursday, Friday, Saturday, and 4 times on Sunday.
Yeah, well, we didn't do a lot of churching when we were growing up.
Yes, sir. Yeah. Yes, sir. So, it was fun.
So, yeah. When did you play in elementary school?
Yeah, I played. Like I said, you didn't really have a choice, because like when you got up in the morning around this house up in here, somebody was doing something. Somebody was playing, or my mother was beating on a pot or something. So we walked to school singing. You get up. I was in there. Plenty of talent shows in school. One in particular was I think I was in the 5th or 6th grade, and my brother was in a band with Richard Boyce, and there's the bags of the cabinets around that time. There's a backup band for the president. And we had a talent show, and the group I was in was called the Soul Sensation. And everybody had brand new amps and drum sets. And I had my little amp, my little guitar that I played with in church. And everybody drowned me out. But my brother Glenn, he came in, and I looked at him. And he said, "That's what you got to play out of." I said, "Yeah." He said, "I'll be right back." He went out not knowing he had the truck outside with all that equipment in it. He came back in, I think that day, in the 6th grade, I dropped out. Everybody on stage, he brought on all his equipment. I loved it that day. Yeah.
So
yeah, awesome school.
So when, so from elementary school to high school, when was your, when did you actually get in your first band?
My first real band was me and my cousin Alan. We had a little band, and then we was called, we didn't even know the name that we wanted to be, but his last name was Wes. So we thought that was cool, so we was called Wes Experience. And we did, I did that. That was like my first band, one of my first bands, yeah.
So
what did you, real bad, yeah.
Yeah, so what instrument did Wes play?
He played bass.
He played bass. So mm-hmm. So what was your first gig with you and Wes? Was it just you and Wes?
No, we had a drummer, his name was Keith Wicks. Yeah, we had a little drummer, Keith Wicks. Yeah. He played drums. Yeah, that's what he did to him, so he played with him. Yeah.
So about how long did you guys last?
It was back in the day we were still in school, going to school, so it was like more or less like a summer type thing. You know, we could rehearse, but you had to be home in time, you know, do your homework and stuff like that. And everybody know back in the day, the streetlights come on, you home, you know what I mean?
Yeah.
So rehearsal time was limited, except for like on the weekend. In summertime, we did a lot, we played every day, every chance. In Plainfield too, every block you went down was a band, so everywhere you went, you could play somewhere. You know, 2-3 steps, there was another band. So
after the band with you and West and Alan, then what was your next step with music?
Okay, with that, it got a little crazy then, because my brother, he was just making a transfer from Bags to Parliament at that time. We was a little bad. He had an idea that
now,
he would get all the
Now, your
brother
was Glenn?
Yes.
Okay.
Yeah, he had an idea that he would come back to Plainfield and he would get all the young local bands to meet over to Jeff Adams' house, which really turned out to be the original drummer for Quazar, because his father had bought up all this brand new equipment for everybody, for his band. His band was named Unlimited Funk. So the day everybody was supposed to get there to meet, to make one band, Jeff was already there because it was his house, and Moochie, which is the bass player for Quazar, he showed up. And I showed up. We were the first three there. And we asked each other, we said, do you know Wish You Were Mine by the Manhattan? And we all said, yeah. So we hit it, blah, 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 blah. And then, then we had to sing the harmonies, and we all fell in the harmonies. Everybody just naturally knew their note. We looked at each other and said, this is the band. And that's how Quazar really came about. We were Eclipse first. We called ourselves Eclipse first. Yeah, and the three of us, we played together, me, Moochie, and Jeff played together without keyboards or anything for about maybe two years. And then my brother came back home, and he said, this is what's going to happen. And it went on from there. That's how Quazar came about. Yeah.
So how long did Quazar stay together?
Quazar, and me, Moochie, and Jeff, and all together at the end of the run, it was about maybe... I actually left out of Plainfield for the first time in 80. So we were together till like about maybe in the 79. But we were together like, me, Moochie, and Jeff were together like from 74 until then.
So tell me about some of the experiences you have with the band. I mean, where did you all go? Who did you open for? How many songs
You want the serious stuff or you want the funny stuff?
I want both.
Okay. the serious is one when my brother came home and said that we were going to Detroit. We had a deal with Westbound Records. We went out to Westbound, and at that time we were called Eclipse. So that was really fun, because I think I might have been like 15, and Jeff, the drummer, we used to call him Baby Jeff. He was like, I think Jeff had just turned maybe 13 or 14, because I remember he always just, everywhere he went, he kept his, security blanket. He carried a security blanket with him for the longest. And that was fun, but that was serious, because we had to go to work. We had to do work. My brother made sure of that. But the funniest one was, my brother took us to the VRE in California, and we had to perform, and everybody was there, Larry Graham, everybody was there. And we get there.
No, name some more people besides, you named Larry Graham. Who else was there that night?
Oh boy, Larry Graham. I merely remember Johnny Kitchar Watson, because I liked the way he played and I got to meet him. Johnny Kitchar, everybody, that was so far back. Everybody was there. Everybody was there. Everybody that was there. I'm trying to think now, but some of everybody. But me, Moochie, and Jeff, since we were like the nucleus of the band, we all hung, we stayed together, we breathed together. We walking around the hotel at the Biltmore, and we going in the door, so we open up the door, we see a band playing, we say, yeah, that's a good band. We go to another door, we see a band. So one door we get to, we open it up, and it's a bunch of people in there in tuxedos and gowns and stuff. So this is not the ERB, this is the door we're not supposed to go in. We turned around, and it's a little Hawaiian guy. Actually, he said, where are you from? I said, I'm from Plainfield, New Jersey. He said something else to me. He asked me to put my hands behind my back. And I looked down, I said, no. So he pushed me. When he pushed me, a little tussle broke out. Come to find out, he was LAPD. But the next day, we had to perform. And everybody, Larry Brown, especially, that's why I remember them so much. And Johnny Guitar Watson, they were the first ones at the gig and to watch us perform. But the funny part was when we got back on the plane, my brother told our manager, which was Robert Middleman, he told Robert Middleman, he said, I should have just brought the buttons. instead of bringing the whole band out there, he should have just brought the buttons. You know, it was going to be that much confusing. That was the funnest trip I ever had in my life.
So you ended up having, how long did you end up staying in California?
When I left in 80?
Yes. How long had you been there?
I stayed, and me and my wife left and told my mother we was going out there for the 4th of July. And when we came back, my mother said that's the longest weekend she ever heard of, because we didn't come back until 85.
That was a long weekend.
We got married out there. We got married in Cali. And that's when I got hooked up with General Kane, a group called General Kane out there. And I was with them for a while. I was with them. Well, we signed to Taboo. We signed to Capitol Records. We did the whole Scandinavian tour. And the last company we were signed with was Motown. We was with Motown.
So that was with General Kane. I remember General Kane.
Mitch McDowell was the leader of the group.
Yes. And because General wore his uniform.
Who?
I said General Kane wore his uniform.
Right, sometimes.
Yeah, sometimes. But tell me about the Scandinavian trip.
Oh, yeah, Scandinavia. That was fun. When I was over there, a lot of times I was over there, I was also over there with a group called Pete Theory out of London. I played with them for like 3 years, and we did like Spain, Sweden. Sweden, I went with General Kane, Amsterdam, Wales.
So how were you received over there? How was the music received?
Oh, when I got there, to be honest, I thought Quazar album had just got released because it was still hot. And I was like, are you serious? Yeah, and they received it real good. They love the funk over there, that's for sure. They love the funk. I seen some guys over there, I was like, nah, they can't play the funk. But when they put up their guitars, I was like, uh-oh. They real with it. Yeah. There's some funky boys over there, that's for sure.
And so you were with General Kane over there, you were with P Theory. Did you live in London when you were with P Theory?
No, most of the time when I was out there, I stayed in like Chester, over there, either Chester, I'm trying to say, in Liverpool, I stayed a lot of time in Liverpool, and Amsterdam. We stayed a lot of time, it was fun in Amsterdam, yeah, most of the time. Because every time I went over there to record, that's where I did the recording at over there. I stayed like four times and we stayed. Each time I went, I think I stayed like a month and a half each time to record. And we did gigs while we were over there too. So it was fun. It was fun, different culture. It was really nice for me. I'm a boy from Plainfield.
Well, let me ask you this. Can you name me three highlights with Quazar that you were with the band? While you're with them, can you name three highlights and then three maybe not so highlighted but they were memorable for you?
Okay, the first highlight was we had to do a show in Long Island at my father's place, because it's a place where you go see the band. Roy Ayers was on the show with us, and it's funny and it was a highlight though too. Because it was a place where you sit down at the dinner table, the dinner club, and you sit there and you listen to the band, no dancing or nothing like that. So we walked in, the club and we go down to the dressing room. My brother, of course, my brother was like, they say I'm the founder of Quazar. I think Quazar actually found each other. You know what I mean? We found each other. My brother was a really big help in getting us to where we were, more than a big help to get us to where we were. But as a founder, nah, we found each other. You know what I mean? In leadership, me, Mooch, and Jeff, we led each other. And my brother was really the leader there. You know, without him, boy, we probably would have still been chasing little girls somewhere. But anyway, my highlight was we went down there and Roy Ayers was playing. We walked in the dressing room and his band, they just looked at us while we was walking through and they started laughing at us. Because we had our little homemade costumes and stuff. We didn't need a dressing room. We came dressed. And and they laughed at us. So when we got in the dressing room, Daryl Dixon was the horn player. He had the horn section called Chops. And we get in the dressing room, and my brother looks at everybody. He says, everybody, which we always do anyway. He said, grab hands. We're going to pray. We prayed. And after he prayed, he said, Daryl, hit it. And Daryl did a saxophone solo. Now it's time for us to go on. When we walked out the dressing room, Roy Ayers band sitting there with serious looks on their face. And we looking at him saying, Y'all thought y'all doubted us, right? We go on stage, we play, people don't sit down. They up on the table dancing, which they wasn't supposed to do, they dancing. The highlight, when we came off stage, my brother grabbed me, Moochie, and Jeff individually and spun us around. While he was spinning us around, he said, y'all did it. And Roy Ayers came on stage. It took him 15 to 20 minutes to explain to the audience the difference between funk and his music. Because we had to bring Roy it Ayers, to you.
I guess Roy Ayers never forgot you guys. I said Roy Ayers didn't forget you guys.
No, he didn't. Neither did Bo Hannon that one time, too. Yeah, we had some fun with Bo Hannon, too. And highlights of, with Quazar was just like seeing everybody. Because Quazar was like we fear God, we love God, you know what I mean? So when we played, it was like, we was just one. It was one, so every time we played, it was like a highlight, but you never knew what was gonna happen next. Who was gonna do something, say, oh man, did he really do that? It was good. It was a highlight. And the saddest, the down one, was when my brother left us. And I can't even think of no other one that was sadder than that, when my brother left. So that was the thing. I could talk about it sometime more now than I used to could, but yeah, that was a big loss, especially in my life, you know.
Well, your brother was, you and your brother did a lot of writing, didn't you? Didn't you?
Yeah, we had fun doing that. I guess you could say because we grew up sitting in the house, same house together. Ooh, I like this. What you think? It's something like that. But after he took off, when my brother took off, it was like more of an honor to see him when he came home because you didn't get to see him that much. So your skills had to be up because you might be like, what you got? You know?
Yeah. But you know, your brother was the foundation of really you moving forward in your music, wasn't he?
Exactly. Yeah. That's true. Yeah. He was. He was the foundation. Yeah. Between him and God, he was the foundation. You're right.
Yeah, because, you know, when even when you go and look up about you, you know, a lot of it gives so much credit to Glenn.
Mm-hmm.
Yes, so.
He was like my idol. He was my big brother. He was my best friend. What else can you put up in there? Everything.
So, you know, I was looking at one of the songs, I think it was it Hey Girl?
Yeah.
Yeah. Can you give me a little Hey Girl?
You're killing me again. Oh,
that. I like that. You know, I was also reading about how your brother and Jerome were inducted into the Rock and Roll Hall of Fame with Parliament and Funkadelics. So.
Yeah, yeah. Me and Jerome, we still doing things together now. I did a gig with Jerome New Year. Yeah, Jerome's still doing his thing. That's my boy. Yeah. Jerome, they I'm glad they did, because Jerome showed me a lot of stuff too. You know, business wise and stuff and how to do things. Jerome was like a brother to me too, because him and my brother was real close and stuff. Yeah.
So you all re-released the album that originally was done when Glenn was, and because Glenn passed right after the original album was completed.
Right.
And so, and then and how has it fared since you re-released it?
Well, I'm gonna keep it real. The re-release of it is, when it got re-released, I knew nothing about it.
Oh, really?
I knew nothing about it. But I don't, you know, it's just strange how things happen, you know. I was getting ready to release, but somebody had released it before I was getting ready to do it. And I had to go about finding another way. And so that was a real crazy time, you know. It was real crazy.
You know, when I look at some of your songs, and I mean, they're really interesting, like Funk with a Big Foot, yeah. Funk with a capital G, yeah. Funk and Roll, Working on the Building, Your Loving is Easy, Love Me Baby, Saving My Love for a Rainy Day, Starlight Circus, and then I know David has told me this song he wanted you to play for me, and just this fast it went away. Did he tell you what he wanted you to play?
Want me to play it?
Yes, David wants you to play it for him.
Okay, I will.
Funky, because it had a little of that Ohio Players thing with it, and I tell you that was your biggest hit, and Funk, get ready to roll.
Yeah.
So, you know, and then when I look at some of the folks that you had on with your personnel, you had, well, we got you, Kevin, which you did guitar and lead vocals. You had Eugene Jackson.
Yeah, that's Moochie.
That's Mookie.
He
played bass, lead, and background vocals. Then you have Richard Banks.
That's keyboard player.
Yeah, keyboards, background vocals. Greg Fitz.
Yeah, keyboard, background vocals.
Jeff Adams.
That's Little Jeff, that's the drummer. He's the youngest one of the Bucks. He's the one we all looked out.
I don't know if I'm going to get this right, but Pichaina?
Patina.
Oh, okay, Patina, okay.
Yeah.
It kind of like Peachina, that's what it looked like. And she was the lead and background singer?
Yeah, she was, and what happened with Patina, I gotta tell a story. Patina was cool, she could sing. Patina actually could sing. She was born church and gospel singer. And my brother brought her to rehearsal. Her and my brother, I believe, met on a mothership on the bus. And he brought her to rehearsal, and he told us that he wanted her to be in the band. And we said, you know, we looked, because we didn't know he never had a girl in the group before, so that kind of struck us kind of funny at the time, but it worked out fine. But my brother's still there sitting in his living room. He has short hair. And my brother Glenn, if you hear me say Mott, that was his nickname. Everybody called him Mott. His name's Glenn Lamott, so we call him Mott. And so Mott said, he put his hand on his head and he said, "You know, you would really look good if you came to rehearsal the next tomorrow with a bald head." And we looked at him. Nobody in the group thought she was going to come back to rehearsal the next day with a bald head. But sure and behold, she walked in rehearsal with a bald head. And that was enough.
But that just goes to show you the power of suggestion.
Yeah, right, no doubt.
Yeah. And then you had Harvey Banks.
Yeah, Harvey Banks was originally from Plainfield. Him and Greg Fitz had a band back in the day called Underground Funk. Like I said, in Plainfield, there was nothing but bands around here. Not a whole bunch of bands like Illusion, Highlight. I could go on Unlimited Funk, which was Jeff, a whole bunch of bands. The Bags, which was Richard Boyce, my brother and them, the Riot. I can go on and name them. Every block from the Eastern to the Western was a band. And musicians-wise, was true. It was a slew of musicians. It was like Eddie Hazel used to sit right in this house with me, and we used to play maybe all day, every day, every other day, whatever day. Then some days he would come by and say he want to go fishing. We would leave to go fishing, take our poles and our guitars with us. No fishing would ever happen. We'd just sit in the woods playing and stuff, drinking our beer and whatever and stuff. But it was Plainfield has a history of funk. There's still some boys running around here in Plainfield that I'm just meeting. And they'd be like, "Yeah, Kev, we know you OG." I was like, "Well, who are you?" And they'd be like, "We can play." Then they start talking, and I played with their fathers. Like, I played my first recording I did was with a gospel group called the Sons of Emmanuel. I think I was 11 years old, and I was playing bass. And believe it or not, the lead singer for that group name was Jesse Scheider, which was Gary Scheider's father. And I played with Gary Scheider. Like, me and Gary Scheider, the whole Scheider family, we're like a family. You know, because his all Gary's brothers and everything, sisters, I think Gary's dog sing. You know, all, everybody in the Shire do something. They do something. And they dance. It's just a whole bunch of people around here playing for that. I'm glad to be saying I am from Plainfield. Like the funk comes from Dayton. A lot of the funk, the slave and them, come from out there. Their voice is bad too. And I think they like the funkiest thing besides Plainfield. And it took me a long time to know that Dayton was really that funky. Oh, I didn't mean to say that.
Yeah. Dayton really is the
yeah, home. I know, yeah.
What about Daryl Dixon? You know, played with you. He played saxophone, clarinet, and flute.
Daryl Dixon is bad. Daryl Dixon is my friend. I'm working on a Quazar Reloaded album, which would be out in a bit with me and my partner, Tony Cox, Anthony Cox, my friend, best friend, and a couple other people like Jim Cooper, Wendell Crawford, Stephen Thrash on drums and stuff. It's a bunch of folks on it, and Daryl Dixon and Chox, they doing the horn section. And Daryl, when I was going to school, he was, sorry about this, Daryl, he was like a substitute music teacher in our school, in the Plainfield High School. You know, I ain't mean to tell. Yep. But Daryl, he's good. He did the horns, drew the horn parts on the new album that's been ready to be released in a couple weeks.
What about Monica Peters?
Monica Peters was one, she was the second girl that was ever in the group, and she played horn, trumpet. When she auditioned for the group out in front of my brother's house, I looked at my brother to ask me, he said, "Kevin, what do you think?" I said, "Mott, she could play." So my entity automatically said that she was in the band. She could play. She was an excellent horn player. She played on Starlight Circus. I think she played flugelhorn on Starlight Circus. She's excellent. Yeah. The whole group was like, the whole Quazar group was, I believe in my heart, that was put together by God. Mm-hmm. You know, when Moochie was the one, because what happened when we was with Westbound, making the transition from Westbound to Arista, we found out that Eclipse, the name Eclipse, had been taken by a group up in Canada, so we had to come up with another name. And Moochie, the bass player, he was off into astrology, and he had these two big blue books. And me and him and Jeff were sitting around, and Moochie, he looked up and he saw this thing called Quazar. He said, "What do you think?" We said, "What does it mean?" And we read it up, and it says, "A bunch of stars, a million of stars gathered together to make one." And we said, yes, that's how we felt about each other. We make one, and that's how Quazar's name came up. And we presented it to my brother, and my brother loved it, and that was it. That was
Quazar. It. Quazar.
Yeah. Yeah.
What about, and I see that you had Daryl, what?
Dino Murdo. He was okay. The cooler player. He came to us from out of nowhere. But he could play. He could play. I think he came. We was doing I forgot where we did a gig at. Where he was gigging at. But he just started playing. And we said we needed somebody to go along with to help Jeff, compliment Jeff a little bit more. And he fitted in right on first.
And then I see you had Daniel Brack.
Daniel Brack. That was Reverend Brack. We call him the Rev. He played keys. He played keyboard. He was a Reverend. Yep, he was the Reverend. He kept the prayer thing going on and stuff. But he the Rev, he was good, yep.
So tell me a little bit about Jerome. We mentioned him, but so the main folks that are still around is probably what? Jerome and you?
Well, out of the original band, me, Mucci, and Jeff, I'm actually the only living one left. Mucci and Jeff have left me. They gone. Mucci left about 15 years ago. Jeff died about 5 years ago. And I'm the only one left. But me and Jerome, we're constantly in touch with each other. We stay together, touch each other. I did like a few gigs with Jerome, Dawn, Mike, me and Mike we did Mike and Cherokee. I did a few gigs with them and stuff. And with what's the group? Clones of Funk out of Maryland, you know them, right?
Yeah,
I did a few things with them and stuff, yeah.
So you know, give me a little sample of Funk with a capital G.
Oh, shoot.
and then, wait a minute, I'm going to get a Space Cadets.
Oh, okay.
Tell me about you and the Space Cadets. That's an interesting name. How did they get that name, Space Cadets? I can understand the name of your Quazar, but I need to understand Space Cadets.
I would say like this. Space Cadets, I don't know how they came up with the name Space Cadets, but it was fitting if you knew Nairobi Steelcat. Because Nairobi Steelcat was the leader of the band, and if you knew him and hung out with him and stuff, he was a space cadet. So it was fitting. It was fitting. But Bernie Worrell actually got me hooked up with that, with Bernie and Jesse Ray and stuff. And it was Bernie Worrell,
Jesse Ray.
Ray
from Scotland? You're talking about Jesse Ray from Scotland?
Yeah, that's one of my best friends, Jesse.
Yes, Jesse.
Yeah, and Fonda Ray and her boyfriend Freddie was down on the album with us, and that was a fun piece of work right there, and with Bernie, because I spent a lot of time with Bernie, and me and my wife really enjoyed Bernie, because one time Bernie and Judy, we had roller skating in New York, and we came back and we wanted to stay at the hotel, so we got stayed at the hotel. We didn't have no way home. Bernie and Judy actually came and picked us up, and we told them we wanted to go home. Judy said, no, we stay the night with them. So we went and stayed the night with Bernie and Judy. And she touched my heart and me and my wife's heart, because she just looked at us and said that my wife and I remind her so much of her and Bernie when they were coming up. And I thought that was, just touched me and stayed with me. All for her to say that was like really special to me. And so it was great.
How was your experience with the Space Cadets?
Space Cadets was fun. I loved it. I loved working with them. And if we weren't in the studio, I was always in New York over Nairobi's house. It might as well have been a studio, because he had a little setup in his house, and we worked all the time. It was fun. And being with Bernie, you can't get no crazier, no more fun, and no more educated than being around Bernie, because he not only was he a comedian, he knew what he was talking about when it comes to music and stuff. So you really stuck out and paid attention. Like Eddie Hazel and Bernie was like a really, really big part in my heart, in my life and my music career besides my brother. You know, because I could relate to them and talk to them. Like, they were straight up, you know, no trying to be here on this different type of level and anything. They kept it real with me, you know what I mean? So that was fun, and that learning process from them.
One of the things I wanted to ask you was that how important has the funk been in your musical career? How important has it been to you?
Funk is my, I can't get away from it. Because first of all, to me, if you've been born and you grew up in a church, and that's where it's at. You know, that you can't run from it, you can't hide from it, you can't do nothing. Everything it's a big part of my life. So if some people ask me now, are you gonna change your style? I'd be like, change what? It's hard, you know, because funk is a big part of life. And funk music is really, to me, it tells a story. It tells a story how a person really feels, you know, inside, if you listen to it and grab it right, you know.
So can you tell me how important you think it is for us to continue to pursue the Funk Music Hall of Fame?
I think that's like one of the best things that ever. I was glad that I could even just open my mouth to be a part of it, because like, I asked a kid the other day, I asked him, have you heard of Parliament Funkadelic? He said, who? You know, it's important. It's important that black kids, all kids of all races know funk. Because you can walk around, I've seen some little white boy, I've seen some Asian group, me and my wife, and these kids was out here. I thought they was born in Plainfield, but they were over there in Korea somewhere. So funk is all over the world. So what you guys are doing is like really great. You can't, I wish I could have came up with the idea, you know? It's great. I know it'll help a lot of people, because if people that love history, they're going to love this. They'll love it. I know I am. I might learn something that I don't even know yet, you know?
There's a lot to be learned, and I think that so many times that when we're talking to people like you, we learn so much, and so many people don't, you know, you're unsung heroes and sheroes of this whole era of music that's not going to go away. It's not going to go away, and we have to tell the story. So I'm asking you, Kevin, to bring Gloria on, because, you know, I had asked Gloria to make sure she said goodbye to me, but I wanted to hear, I want to just ask Gloria a couple of questions, if you don't mind.
Uh-oh. Yeah. I'm saying you got nothing to do with alimony.
Gloria, thank you. I just need you to share with me, what has your experience been as the wife of a musician, a total, truly committed musician?
Challenging. And very challenging, very exciting. Just to be in the midst of the many people that I have met through my husband. See, when I first came around, Quazar was rehearsing in the basement of his brother's house, Kevin Goins. And the harmony that I heard from those three guys, when then it was another guy, Greg Fitz. Of them, the harmony that I heard come from them was like voices from heaven. Nothing that I had heard from before. And I think they were a perfect fit. And along with the management and the leadership of Glenn Goins, if things hadn't turned out the way they were, I'm sure they would have went a lot further in their careers as Quazar. I'm sure some of them branched out and they went and did their own thing. But as far as being the unit of Quazar, I think a lot more could have been accomplished if their leadership didn't leave.
You know, I think it's so important that, you know, we hear that from you, because you're there, and you see the ups, you see the downs, you see the good, you see the bad, you see the excitement, and you're all around. You're the fixer. Well, you're the fixer. I know you are. So
in some instances.
You have a bigger role than your paycheck shows.
Thank you. But it's been very interesting. I don't think there's anything that I would change. And for everything to turn out the way it did, each person have gone their separate ways, but I'm sure they have been successful in whatever role they decided to take after Quazar, because they were all talented, very talented as a unit and very talented as the, you know, within themselves. You were a self-contained group. So just the group itself, the way they started out and the big loss that they have, you know, the music, Kevin's brother, but he left a lasting impression on them, the importance of hard work, rehearsing. He was a stickler about rehearsing and making it perfect.
And slide over, I think, a little bit, Gloria.
Excuse me?
Slide over a little bit.
This way?
Yeah, that's it.
I was trying to stay in my lane, you know, in the background.
I know.
But it's like I said, it's been a great journey. And for us to end up where we are now, I'm grateful.
Thank you, Gloria. Thank you, Kevin. You know, this is Rhine McLin, host of the Funk Music Hall of Fame and Exhibition Center award-winning show, Funk Chronicles. Until next time, keep it funky.
Will everyone please rise? Thank you.